Hey sweet friend, welcome back to my channel. My name is Maylene Call from Mrs. Call's Campers. If you're new here, I taught first grade and then I taught kindergarten and I'm currently job searching. School actually starts next Thursday, so I should know this upcoming week if I will have a job. So I want to say really quickly, a portion of this video is sponsored by CRICUT. I'm going to be showing you guys how to make a super fun doormat. This is the doormat that I designed for my classroom this upcoming year, and I'm going to show you how to make it with CRICUT later on in the video. I'm really, really hoping for this first grade position. Again, I am vlogging my whole interview experience, so you'll see that. But today is just a very chill, chatty video. I am quite literally just brainstorming my year for you, and not in any kind of structured way, so get comfortable. I'm just going to be sharing ideas as they pop up, as they come to me. I'm going to be looking through my Instagram and talking about things that I want to do this next year if I have a job, and I'm going to be going through some of my saved posts on Instagram too and talking about some ideas that I want to try by maybe one of you guys. So that being said, not a lot of structure to this video. We are just hanging out. It's nighttime. I lit a candle for you. You probably won't see it most of the time because I'm going to put things on the screen, but it's the thought that counts. Okay, really quickly, if you do not have a document that you can type in that's ready to go, grab one or grab a notepad or something, because this entire video is just going to be ideas for the school year. I thought it would be super, super helpful just to hear what a teacher who's been teaching at least 2 years now is thinking about. I don't want you to be overwhelmed with the ideas, but I'm just wanting to give you inspiration and you can take what you need from the video as you see fit. So the first thing I'm thinking about is morning journals. I did these in kindergarten and loved them. The kind I use are from Erin Waters, and I would love to do this again in first grade. When I taught first grade back in Tennessee, I did STEM bins. So as the kids arrived, because they arrived at different times in the morning, they just came in, grabbed a STEM bin, worked on a prompt that was on the board, and that was great. And I still might incorporate that again this year. But once school starts and everybody is there, then I'm gonna have them do like a 5-minute morning journal. I also love using STEM bins as early finisher or even just free choice at the end of the day. They love it too. And thinking about the beginning of the day actually has me thinking about the end of the day, and something I wanna do at the end of the day is our choice song. Those of you who remember my like OG classroom setup videos, I came up with this little choice rap to end our day and my kids loved it. I didn't do it in kindergarten last year. I didn't do a lot of the things that I would normally want to do last year because of COVID. So let's just put that into perspective. So we didn't do this, but if I teach again this year, I'm definitely doing it. I'm gonna wrap it for you now. Also, what I did was I wrote this out on an anchor chart paper and it was like hanging above my whole group area, like attached to the ceiling, so that we could practice it all year. But towards the end of the year, we did this like when they were in line. Sorry, it's so early in the video. When we leave, we have a choice to make. What we believe becomes what we say. What we say becomes what we do. It's up to me. It's not up to you. I'm in charge of me. I'm a go-getter. Call me weak, I know better. I make strong choices every day. And when I leave, just watch me. Hey, I make strong choices. I love that little rap. My kids loved it too. It is embarrassing as it is for me to sit here and do it for you guys. Maybe you like it and want to use it. So I'll put the lyrics in the description box. That rap will get stuck in your head. And since we're talking about songs, another thing that I want to do is another song that I wrote for my kids. I actually have a whole Instagram highlight on some songs that I use for different subject areas. But one song that I used last year that worked so well is our Writing Superstar song. My parents loved it. Well, I don't know if they loved it, but they knew their kids loved it because their kids were singing it at home. And I have this post on Instagram for you here. But it's, I'm a writing superstar, 5 big goals I know by heart, capital letter, always first, finger spaces between words, sound them out the best you can, punctuation at the end, go back and check, we do our best, go back and check, we do our best. A little bit slower, I'm just trying to get through it for y'all. But the Writing Superstar song gives them all the things they need for a superstar sentence. Love it, we'll definitely be bringing it to first grade. Really quickly, I made something today. I wanna grab it and show you in case you're not following me on Instagram, which if you are not, please consider doing so. We have lots of fun and you guys usually get to see everything first. This is my Meet the Teacher letter. no, I don't have a job yet. There's only so much I can do without knowing if I have a job. And a meet the teacher letter, brochure, trifold is one of those things that I can do. I shared this on Instagram this morning, but this is what it looks like. If you watched my videos my first year of teaching, I did a flip book and the flip book was good. But this year I know I'm going to be limited on time and I don't want to print a million papers. So I'm putting all my information in this little flipbook. I have the template in my free resources link on Instagram. So if you click the link in my Instagram, click free resources. This is in the classroom section. And this is what it looks like. Has meet the teacher on this side. This talks about homework. This talks about our classroom. This is the skills for first grade. This is something that I think is going to be super valuable to parents. And then on the back, just has obviously a fake schedule, but it will be the real schedule. We hope, right? Okay, so I'll be doing this year, just a simple brochure, meet the teacher, classroom information, letter, trifold. Let's see, the other thing I wanna be bringing back into my classroom are bee binders. I used them my first year teaching because my team did, and I like them. I used just regular folders with kindergarten this year, and I really just think binders are better. So if you can, great. If not, that's okay too. I have a template up on TBT for you that's editable. It has bee binder, all sorts of resources. If you are interested in it, you could check it out here. Now I'm going to be going to my phone for the inspo and info sharing. Okay. I talked in my last video, my classroom hall video, about the voice level system I used for first grade and kindergarten, and I'll try to focus it here. You can't really tell here. I'm going to insert the picture for you. And I will not be using those this year. If you saw my classroom hall video, I'm going to be using one light that changes colors, and each color will coordinate with the voice level, and that'll just work better for so many reasons. Still going to be using center folders for sure. I'm still going to be using my wooden crate system for papers throughout the week. So what I like to do is have students only take homework on Fridays. So throughout the week, I will just sort their papers into a folder that has their number, and then on Fridays, I just give it to them and they put it in their folder. That works well for me versus sending things home every day. One thing I'm not going to be doing this year is having a physical calendar in the room, which is so funny to think about, because when you think of an elementary school classroom, you think of, some teachers even have an entire wall dedicated to calendar routine, which is usually done during math. You have your calendar, what day is it, you do the patterns, you do making groups of 10, you're counting the days in school, you're doing place value, you cover so much during calendar time. But I will be doing it digitally. I will not be having a physical calendar. For me, I think it's just way easier. You can make it super interactive with the kids. I'm sure you'll hear me talk all about it. It also makes it bigger, a lot bigger, so everyone can see. And the other thing is, it doesn't take up wall space. And to me, wall space is so precious in the classroom. So digital calendar. This one is a good one, my book tracker. I've talked about this before. You probably haven't heard me share about it in a long time because I didn't do it with kindergarten because we were virtual. But when I was in first grade, I took one of those Dollar Tree frames and I just put a piece of paper in, and I used it to track the number of books with an expo marker. So every single time we read a book, I would have a student bring me the book tracker and we would add a book to our book tracker. And so this was really motivating because they always wanted me to read books, and we celebrated when we got to 100 books. I don't think we actually did anything, we just cheered, and it was just a really big deal. So yeah, that was really special, and it created a love around books and reading in the classroom. So I love that. I'll be doing that again. Okay, I'm seeing my post of the Bluetooth microphone. I love my Bluetooth microphone. I loved it my first year of teaching, but this past year with COVID, I used, you guys saw, a little like Britney Spears mic, and I think I like it better. I love that it's hands-free. So this next year teaching, regardless of if we're wearing masks or not, I will probably be using a microphone. It's just so much easier, and you can do things like whisper, and they'll still be able to hear you super clear. And especially for times like if you're out on the playground, there's just so many uses for it. So I think the Bluetooth microphone is gonna be more a student microphone, and I'm gonna use the little headset. Next up is my worry plaque. Again, something I use my first year of teaching and couldn't use last year because of COVID. But you put your hand on it when a student is worried, and it's red and it slowly fades to green, and it has this whole thing like the fairies are taking away your worries. I used it in my calm corner, which I will be having again. I used it in kindergarten, I used it in first grade. It's something that I think is essential to a classroom to help kids self-regulate, to give them a space to go. So all that I will be doing again this year. Ooh, next thing I think is really fun. I did a door coloring page around like Christmas time with my kids, and I loved the idea of my kids helping me decorate the door. So depending on what kind of classroom I have this year, I think this could be a really fun idea. When I had inside hallways at my first school, it was perfect. Here in California, there's outside doors, so it's not really as easy to do, but yeah, I love the idea, and maybe you would want to do this too. Then we have a memory interactive bulletin board display. I had a lot of categories my first year teaching, and while I loved the idea, it was hard to keep up with, so I'm going to narrow it down to about 6 categories. I think the ones I want to keep are: we were in shock when these things happened, basically like a funny moments thing, a friendship one, things that we learned about that were really interesting, we learned how to make the world better, just a couple of different things. And anytime we have like a memory like that, you write it down, stick it in the envelope, and at the end of the year you go through and you read them all together and kind of relive the memories. I love the idea, but less categories. You guys already know I'm gonna be doing book bins again this year with my flexible seating. I'm gonna be using Class Dojo coupons this year again too. Class Dojo is one of my favorite things, but it is also not a behavior management system. If you haven't seen my video on Class Dojo, I posted it like 2 or 3 years ago at this point. Click up here to watch it. I tell you all about what it is, how I use it. I'm sure you already know what it is, but in case you needed a few more ideas, I have that video there for you. But I use it as a positive reward system in my class, and I like it because students always have different points because they're spending coupons. So it's never like, oh, John is the best student because he has 30 points right now and everyone else only has 15 points. No, they're constantly spending points, earning points, so their number values are always changing, so you can't really pinpoint like so-and-so is doing better, whereas like with a clip chart you would just see it. So definitely gonna be using Class Dojo again. I'll probably be using Class Dojo forever. Okay, this I feel like you've heard me talk about so much, but I love the What Should Danny Do books, and I'm gonna be reading What Should Danny Do School Day, our first week or 2 weeks of school. There's different endings to the What Should Danny Do stories, so it's like a choose your own adventure series, and they have a school day one, so it kind of helps kids get back into the routines, and it's a safe place for them to make choices because they're on the carpet and it's not them making the choice, it's Danny making the choice, so they can kind of see actions, consequences, and kind of explore behaviors without acting them out. So I love the What Should Danny Do books. We'll definitely be reading that book in particular the first week, 2 weeks of school. It does take a while to get through the different endings. We just do it in our spare time, but I love those books. Another thing I really liked doing was having vocabulary words pulled from my read aloud every week. So I think we did maybe 3 or 4 vocabulary words when I was in first grade. And what I did was I would have a word, say the word in our book that week was determined. And I was like, okay, this is a word I want my first graders to use. No, determined. So I thought in my head of like a picture that would go with it. And the picture I ended up using for determined was like a mouse trying to get cheese from a mouse trap. So the mouse had like a helmet on and it was ready to get that cheese and it was determined to do it. So I find kid-friendly pictures to those vocabulary words, which can be tricky sometimes. You have to be a little creative and it takes extra time. I really liked having our vocabulary words right in the front of the room because they would actually use them in their writing. So we had words like fumble, reveal, giggle, puny, disaster. I will be using iWords again. I have a code for iWords. I'll leave the info for you on screen and in the description box. But if you are required to teach some kind of sight words in your classroom, keep in mind I have been very into the science of reading lately, which definitely emphasizes mapping out sight words and not just memorizing sight words, but I think iWords really help. They have pictures to go along with the words, and in my experience, they work really well. So I have a link in the description box for iWords if you want to at least look at them. I got the digital cards and then just printed them, but they have physical cards and they have a lot of other things that go with it too, and I really like them, so I'll leave that link for you there. I also talked about this in my classroom haul video, but I am doing secret stories this year in my room. I could not be more excited. I've been finishing the professional development for, it's actually the kindergarten professional development, but that's okay because I'm still getting all the information. And just the way that Katie Garner explains the secret stories and how they help children makes total sense. And I've heard nothing but good things about secret stories. So I'm really excited to bring that into my classroom. I know I've already mentioned it. This is a good one. Primary Scouts on TPT. She just like needs a portion of my paycheck every month. She makes read aloud resources, retail resources. If you're a kindergarten teacher especially, you need to follow this woman on TBT. I'm sorry you already missed the sale if you didn't buy anything from her, but I have her like year-long bundle of retail. I love everything she does. Here's an example. It's just, it's so engaging, it's so helpful, takes all the stress off of you, and it helps you find new read alouds. I found one of my favorite books through her, Dandy. Now one of my favorite books, my kids loved it so much. So I love her and I'm gonna be using lots of her resources even in first grade. Okay, another big one is ESGI. This is a game changer. Again, when I had my first year of teaching, I was in first grade, but the kindergarten team used ESGI, and I remember our first grade team just being like, oh, I wish we had it, I wish we had it. And I was like, what is it? I didn't really know, but it is a progress monitoring tool. It is online, so you could do it virtual if you needed to. I did it virtual for the majority of the year. It is the best thing ever. I know as teachers, sometimes we like to have the pencil, the paper, and the checks, and all of that stuff, but this saves you so much time. I love it so much. Again, really quickly, I have a code for you. You can get a free trial. I think it's like a 60-day free trial. Try it out. Just hear me out. Try it out. You will love it. It automatically creates data for you. It creates graphs for you. It creates parent letters for you, class statistics super easily. You don't have to take all of your sheets of paper and then put them into an Excel sheet or do something else with it. Like, it's all done for you. You don't even have to make the tests if you don't want to. You could just search for whatever standard you're doing and find a test for it. It is that easy. It also makes your small groups way more effective because you can test your kids easier. So I can literally pull a kid to my back table, pull up the test I need on my iPad super quick. Yes, no, did they get it, not get it? And then bam, I have instant data, and it is so much faster than pencil and paper. And also it's a little bit more exciting for the kids too. A lot of people, when they think of ESGI, think of like, oh, it's just for like beginning and end of the year assessments, but it's so easy to do them throughout the year. It'll hold you more accountable. It'll make your small groups better. Your principal will probably love it. It's the best thing ever. Again, my code is Miss Call. You can do a 60-day free trial. Link is in the description. It's awesome. I'm so glad I started using it. There's also this anchor chart, which I shared about recently on my Instagram, so you can go read the caption on it to learn all about how I use it, but it is our Be a Leader, Not a Boss. That's kind of like our class motto in a way, and that's basically how I structure my classroom management. A lot of my classroom management is done through conversations, and we talk about solutions, we talk about problems, we talk about what's gonna happen, all those other things. So at the core of it, relationships, but on the outside, it's Be a Leader, Not a Boss. Talk about what a leader might do, and then on the flip side, what a boss might do. So for example, a leader fixes problems, a boss blames other people. So just common situations that you might have in your classroom, and I'm encouraging my kids to be leaders. This is one of my favorite things ever. Again, read the post if you want to hear me chat more about it. Okay, before we talk about some posts that I have saved on Instagram, I want to show you something really exciting. I found this company called Green Elephant Home. They are really small right now. I think on Instagram they only have like 3,500 followers, which for a company is small. I'm not saying like if you have 3,500 followers, because that's a lot, but for a company. I reached out to them. I asked if they would give me a code for you guys. The code is MissCall10. Let me show you what I got. You guys remember when I moved into the kindergarten classroom last year and had to clean out so many toys? There were way way too many toys. I love toys. Love toys for kinder, love toys for first grade, second grade, all the grades love toys. But the kind of toys I like are more open-ended toys, toys that you can create with, toys that stimulate your mind and help you think of stories around the toys. So when I found this company, I was like, yes, give me all the things. So let me show you what I bought. And just to preface this, if you know what this is, you know the price tag on these is high. Or even if you like try to find one on Amazon, the price tags are high. This company makes these toys so affordable. I am so excited about this, you guys. So they have it in like the wood version, and they also have it in like more like a primary color rainbow, but I just got the pastel version. I know when you think of this, you probably think like toddler, because you tend to see them a lot in nurseries, but these will be so beneficial to your kindergartners, first graders. They're going to love it. I mean, what first grader wouldn't be attracted to this? I also got these building boards, and they stack with the rainbows. I'll show you guys. I got a bunch of wooden trees. There's a couple more down here. And then I got two sets of these like wooden peg people, and I purchased two sets of them because I wanted to make sure like there were enough. And honestly, I was playing with this thing for like 20 minutes when I got it, just trying to like see all the fun things that I could come up with. So I think I'm gonna get another rainbow, because I think it's gonna be a hot commodity, and the last thing I want is my first graders, hopefully first graders. I'm saying it like I have the position, because I really, really want it. Last thing I want is any of my kids to be, you know, fighting over toys. So I want to make sure I have plenty. So I'll probably be buying another rainbow. But yeah, I bought the dolls, the trees, the boards, and the rainbow. Something I plan on doing is having like pictures for them. So I'll let them free build with it for a while, and I might slowly take pictures of the things they create and then make it into like a little book of ideas. Look how cute. It's like a little frog or something. I don't know. There's just so many like cool things that you can do with these that I didn't even know you could do. I will say I did get the colored version of these, because you guys know like I'm a neutrals gal when it comes to like my own classroom organization and things like that. But for the kids, I think colors are something that they need. And I would actually recommend, if you do get these, not to get the plain wooden. There's like a wooden rainbow set that's like natural wood color. I would recommend that you get the colors, because it will help a lot with their creations that they make. Like for example, this could be grass. This could be the pool. I'm gonna build this really quickly. Like, you're telling me your kids would not be interested in building this? Yes, they would. Like, look how fun that looks. And then you could take your little people and put them inside. Actually, when I was playing with this, I made like a little apartment complex. So I had like some over here. Look how cute that is. So I had like the grass, and then part of... Did I say I was obsessed? I'm obsessed. So my code is MissCall10. And their prices are already super affordable, like cheaper than Amazon. I'm telling you guys, I feel like this is one of those things that like everyone's gonna have in their classroom pretty soon, because who wouldn't love this? I cannot wait to show you all the awesome things that my kids come up with. And like I said, I'm gonna be buying another rainbow. I'm gonna hop into the future. Thank you so much to Cricut for sponsoring this portion of the video. I'm gonna be showing you guys how to make your very own doormat for your classroom, for your house. You could make it as a gift for someone else. I think that would be a really nice personal touch. And today I'm gonna be using my Cricut Explore Air 2, which is this machine you see sitting right here. You guys have seen me make a few projects with my Cricut over the years on my channel. Some of my favorites are customizing things with labels. I like making bulletin boards. The last video that I partnered with Cricut on, you guys saw me do the pencil pouches for my students' end of the year gifts. And then after that, I actually used it again to make silhouettes for parent gifts. So I use my Cricut for a ton of things. It cuts over 100 materials, and whatever you need to make, this can help you do it. So I have a link if you want to check it out. But the materials you're going to need for today are a doormat. Obviously, I got this one from Target because I liked the quality and I've purchased mats from Target in the past and they've held up really, really well. The other thing you're gonna need is your mat. I'm gonna be using a larger mat because it fits the size of my doormat a little bit better. You could use the standard mat, which is about half the size. It's 12 by 12, this one's 12 by 24. It would just involve a little bit more work on your end. So if you're going for the doormat, I would invest in one of these because you can also use it throughout the year and it will cut more things without you having to switch mats. You're also going to need vinyl. Permanent vinyl is probably gonna be your best bet for this project. Then I am going to be using Flex Seal to create the design on the mat. This is really highly recommended by everyone who does doormats and it holds up really well according to them. So I opted for this over just regular paint. If you do use regular paint, I would suggest that you go over it with some kind of clear outdoor protective coating, but to avoid that, I'm just gonna be using Flex Seal. The other thing you're gonna see me use today is painter's tape. This is just to secure our stencil to the mat. Unless you're gonna need either transfer tape or just regular packing tape, and I'm gonna use this to go ahead and clean off all of the extra fuzzies off of the mat before we go ahead and lay our stencil down and start picking up all those fuzzies from the mat. The other thing is, if your mat has any of these like longer pieces, just pull them out of your mat. I had this idea to make a classroom mat at the end of last year, actually, and I was really excited when Cricut reached out and said they wanted to sponsor another video, so. Okay, so the first thing you wanna do is open Cricut Design Space. Again, if you wanna use my design, I'm sharing it with you guys. Okay, here's what the project is gonna look like if you wanna make it. I have each of these on a separate little cutting mat for you so you can cut it in a bunch of pieces and it'll be easier. I'm going to show you how I did this. So you're going to open up Design Space, a new project. You can go to templates and pick one of Cricut's templates, or you could add their text and do what you'd like. I'm going to show you just the basic process. So I have this in separate pieces. I'm going to insert the first part of our doormat. I made this really large. Hold on. We're going to make that a little bit smaller. And I'm gonna add the rest of my pieces in really quickly. Okay, so I have three separate pieces right now, and let's just pretend you had just this one piece for your design. Here's the basics of what I like to do. First thing is I'm going to open up a shape and I'm gonna make it a square. I'm gonna change the color to something to resemble my mat, and then I'm gonna go over to this lock button under size and I'm gonna press it so that it unlocks, and I'm gonna change the size to the size of my doormat, which mine is 30 by 18, and this kind of just shows me what my doormat looks like. You can right click it and send it to the back. Then you can arrange your design. So if you're just doing one design, it'll be the simplest thing, and then you can make sure it looks good. I'm gonna show you what I did really quickly. I just resized it and got the size that I wanted it to be on my doormat. Took our little plant buddies up here. Said, okay, yeah, that looks great. And now I'm going to delete my doormat because we don't need it. The next part, now that everything is sized, is you want to create your stencil. So you're gonna go over to shapes and you're gonna select the square again, and you're gonna create a shape for the size of your mat. So if you're using the standard Cricut mat that's 12 by 12, you would click the unlock button and you would do 11.5 by 11.5. You want your size to be a little bit smaller than your mat so that it all fits. I am not doing 12 by 12, so I'm gonna make it 23.5 by 11.5, and that is the size for the larger cutting mat. So this is my cutting mat, and now we're gonna make the stencil. So again, if this was your only design for your doormat, you would only have to do this one time. I'm gonna do it a couple of times because I have different pieces to my doormat. So what you wanna do is position it how you would like, and then you wanna highlight both of these pieces. So you can hold the command button, select the other piece, and you have two pieces selected now, or what you can do is just mouse over both pieces and they're both selected. The magic button down here is slice. You want to press slice in order to get that stencil. So now when I drag it off, I have the stencil. This is what you're gonna be using to create your design, remember, because we're gonna be spraying down the letters. So again, I already did this part for you in my file, but this is just a tutorial on how you might do it if you were creating your own from scratch. The magic button down here is slice. So I'm gonna do it one more time so you can see. Let's do it with the plant buddies, but let's actually do it with just one. So I'm gonna do a shape, a square, and the other thing you can do is unlock it in this bottom corner right here, and you can just cover your design with your shape make sure they're both selected, and then hit slice one more time. And then you've got another stencil. So that's the basics to doing it. Then once you're done, you're gonna go over to make it, hit continue, and then you're gonna select your device and your vinyl, and then you're just gonna go.
It's blinking at me to load my mat, so I'm gonna get my vinyl ready and do that. And while my Cricut does all the work for me, I can go do something else. The first part is done. I just peeled the whole sheet of vinyl off of the mat. Let's get ready for our second mat. I find that weeding the pieces off of the actual mat itself is way easier than the alternative. Okay, I actually slid a poster board underneath my mat. It is all taped off except for the parts that I want to spray, and I'm gonna take it outside. Here's what she looks like. I'm gonna give it like 15 or so minutes, and then I'm gonna come and peel off the vinyl, and then I'm gonna let it dry for like 45 minutes to an hour. The mat is not fully dry yet, but I took the stencil off and I'm gonna let it dry outside for another hour or so, but I had to show you, it looks so good. Okay. Are you kidding? It looks so professional. I am in awe. Honestly, I made that. I messed up the stencil a little bit on that stem, but that's okay because plants aren't perfect in real life. Also, I'm not perfect either. And it's also a little bit off center on the bottom, but that's okay. It's all okay. I am so proud of this. This is my favorite Cricut project to date. I would highly recommend it. Some things that will make this project go smoother. Number one, you need to be using permanent Cricut vinyl. Do not try to use removable vinyl. I tried removable vinyl for the plants just to compare it for you. It does not stick nearly as well. Use permanent vinyl if you do this project. Second tip I have for you is to work in smaller chunks. So I had this whole top section as one chunk. What I did for the file, if you want to make this exact mat, is I went ahead and chunked each word up for you just so you'd have a smaller piece to work with, and that'll make it easier too. And the last tip is when you are spraying your flex seal, spray directly down. I did a combination between like little bit of side to side motion and then just straight up squirts. But look really closely at your design on all the edges and make sure that you hit every single spot. I can't wait to put this outside my door. The fact that I made it is also just really satisfying. Okay, we're gonna hop back into the video. Everything you need for this project is linked in the description box for you. We are back. Okay, so let's talk about some other ideas that I have for the school year. Now let's go into our saved posts on Instagram. I have been saving so many posts lately. There's just been so many good ideas. So let me scroll. Actually, we'll start at the top. I actually reposted this in my stories today, but it's back to school STEM building challenges. This is by The Meaningful Teacher, and she has building prompts for them. So build something that represents who you want to be, build something that represents you, build something that represents your favorite game. And this is a great back to school activity in my opinion. Another great back to school activity I saved is by Bethany, Raise the Bar Education. She is so sweet, I love her. She has like a roll of yarn, and you start with it and you say their name and their favorite part of the day. So you do it at the end of the day and you say, my name is Maylene, my favorite part of today was recess. And then you toss the yarn to someone across from you in the circle, and it ends up building this beautiful web, and you talked about how you're a community and you're all connected. And I love that idea. I thought it was the sweetest thing ever. Another one that's more back to school themed is by Teach with Sparkle. And she basically, the second day of school, kind of talked about everything that her kids did awesome on the first day of school, which
on the first day of school, of course, all day long, you're saying, wow, I love that so-and-so did this. We did a great job doing this. Let's do, you know, you compliment them all day long. But I think that's really smart to go into the second day or the second week talking about your strengths as a class to kind of keep that momentum going. I loved that. Post is by Kelly's Classroom. She made an art cart. I would set mine up a little differently. I wouldn't use glass jars for it, but I love the idea of an art cart if you don't have space in your room for like an art center, kind of like I had when I taught kinder this past year. I like the idea of using tools from Michael's and the cart and hanging the scissors on the side. But yeah, I wouldn't use the jars. I'd use more like organizational bins, but I like the idea of an art cart. And then Research and Play shared a reel on her play centers. And what stood out to me was that she used the IKEA, I think they're called Tolsby frames, like the little tabletop frames. A lot of teachers use them for a lot of different things, but she had a picture of the play tool or game, and she would take the picture frame and put it where they were supposed to play with that certain item. And I think that's really helpful for me. I usually just let my kids take things wherever, but things like Play-Doh, I definitely want to have a specific spot, and I think having that signage would really help. So I love that idea. Another thing I saved was from Learning in Wonderland, which is so funny because she's one of the first accounts that I ever followed, like as a student teacher. And she said that she prints her labels for her composition notebooks, which I use all the time in my classroom. She prints them on shipping labels. And I was like, that's kind of genius. What I do is I print them, laminate them, and I staple them onto the cover, but I might invest in shipping labels this year because I think that's so smart. This idea is by Miss Morgan on Instagram, and she had her kids work on patterns with lights, or you could also have them show like a number in a 10 frame. Genius idea. I don't need to explain it, but genius. Love it. You can get lights like this at Dollar Tree. The other thing that I'm really interested this year that I know I probably won't be trained on this year just because I know it's expensive and it's a really big process, but being OG trained, Orton Gillingham trained on the science of reading is a goal of mine, like a professional goal that I have. I find it so interesting. I'm a member of the Facebook group. So if you look up the science of reading, what I wish I had learned in school or what I wish I had learned in college, join that Facebook group if you are an educator. It is so helpful. It is so helpful. And one of the resources I found through that Facebook group was the Reading Simplified Academy. And I took one of her free PDs and she reeled me in. She made me buy the membership, and I did. It's like a monthly membership. And I'm not like pitching it to you or anything. I'm just saying I've learned a lot from it. And some of the strategies she talks about are really helpful for elementary level students because it's all about teaching the foundational skills. And she shares some really awesome activities and proof of her working with students and seeing them gain all of their sounds. And it's just incredible to see it. And I've been doing a lot of PD recently, and the whole academy is just PD videos, and every time you do a video, you kind of get like a resource to go with it, or not every time, I don't know. Structured in a way to where you get the information and then you can go apply it. So their framework is based on a handful of activities that integrate multiple processes, a streamlined pathway versus hundreds of standards, and then basing it on students' instructional needs. Completely has already changed the way I think about teaching, and I really like it and I find it very valuable. So if you could ask your school to maybe pay for it, it would be helpful, I think. If you're in college, I wouldn't necessarily say to go for it. I would wait till you're a teacher just because you kind of need... She breaks it down for you very well, but also I don't think if I was in college I would have been ready for this information. Like, you need your foundational skills to really be able to do it effectively, in my opinion. Those are just a couple of things that I wanted to chat with you about, some things that I'll be doing this year. Hopefully you guys will know soon enough. But I just wanted to create a video that was helpful and shared a bunch of ideas, things that I want to use in my real life, things that I have used in my real life, things that I know work, things that I'm hoping will work, things I'm excited to try, in hopes that you get a little bit inspired. So like this video if you found anything helpful. Leave me a comment. Let me know some great ideas that you have for this school year, or if you heard any of these ideas that I shared with you and you want to try them out. I love talking about back to school. I love sharing back to school information. I'm a little bit overwhelmed
overwhelmed with how much I have to do if I get hired, but I'm also really excited at the opportunity. So keep your fingers crossed for me that I get this position, and I will see you guys in the next video, which will more than likely be the interview vlog, and you will find out if I will be teaching this year or not. I love you guys so much. Make sure you are subscribed, connect with me over on Instagram, say hi, we have a lot of fun over there. I love you so much. Have a beautiful night, have a beautiful back to school season, and I will see you in the next one.